Just like we incorporate multiple time frames to help identify trends, just like we incorporate multiple time frames using our trend lines, we want to do the exact same thing when it comes to momentum. One of my favorite examples is actually Apple in 2009 through 2012. This was an epic top in shares of Apple that started a pretty substantial decline, temporary, but a decline nonetheless. You have a beautiful uptrend from the lows in early 2009, touched again in 2011, and then the trend line broke. But what happened prior to this trend line breaking? We had a bearish momentum divergence. So now we're looking at a weekly chart of Apple showing a bearish momentum divergence, a heads up that something's wrong. Then we go to the daily time frame. We start with the top and work our way down. So we have a bearish divergence on the weekly time frame, and now we turn our attention to the daily time frame, and sure enough, on the new high in the second half of 2012, momentum is putting in a lower high and then getting oversold. All bearish characteristics. These are things we see in downtrends, in markets that are heading lower, not in strong uptrends. So we want to bring it all together here by now incorporating that relative strength. We're looking at a ratio chart of Apple compared to the S&P 500. So we had a bearish momentum divergence on the weekly, a bearish momentum divergence on the daily, and now when you compare Apple to the rest of the market, once again in the second half of 2012, we have a bearish divergence in Apple relative to the S&P 500. Higher highs in the ratio, lower highs in momentum, quickly oversold. These are characteristics of downtrends. So if you caught the weekly, you caught the daily, and then you looked at the relative strength ratio, you had three things telling you the exact same outcome would occur. Get out of the market. So when it comes to weighing the evidence and incorporating multiple time frames, when it comes to momentum, we want to do the same thing.